Once the amino acid composition of a polypeptide is known, the next question is to determine its sequence. And here the easiest question to address is, what's the N-terminal residue? This is easy because it takes advantage of the nucleophilic character of the amino group at the one end of the polypeptide chain that's reacted specifically with a tag molecule. The tag is something that bears a unique chemical or spectroscopic signature, such as the absorption of light at a particular wavelength or fluorescence at a particular wavelength, where none of the amino acids give rise to that same kind of spectroscopy. The tag molecule is put on covalently in such a way that when the polypeptide chain bearing one tag per polypeptide is subjected to hydrolysis under HCl aqueous conditions, a mixture of amino acids is obtained, one of which, the one that was on the N-terminal position, still contains the tag, and then there's a whole bunch of untagged amino acids. This mixture is subjected to that chromatographic analysis where there's an elution series, a time-dependent separation, and based on the time that the tagged molecule elutes, it's possible to identify what was the amino acid that was on the end of the chain. Back in Sanger's day, the tag chemistry involved using a dye molecule that absorbed at a particular wavelength. In this case, it was a yellow-colored dye that absorbed around 400 nanometers. And it used the dinitrofluorobenzene group that's now known as Sanger's reagent. Basically, this is taking advantage of nucleophilic aromatic substitution, where the amino group reacts with the carbon that is carrying the fluorine to do a substitution of fluorine for nitrogen. And now the new bond that's formed is not susceptible to hydrolysis, so that when all the peptide bonds break, there's going to be one amino acid, whatever that amino acid residue happens to be, that's going to carry this tag, and it can be uniquely identified following chromatography. Today, more common than Sanger's reagent is Danzo Chloride. Danzo Chloride has this sulfonyl chloride group, and it reacts with amino groups by an addition elimination process and makes the sulfonamide. The sulfonamide is also very resistant to hydrolysis, and Danzo Chloride, once it forms a sulfonamide, is strongly fluorescent. The fluorescence gives the unique signature that doesn't show up by any of the other amino acids. This is the absorption spectrum of danzo chloride. It absorbs around 350 nanometers, and then it has this very large, what's known as a large Stokes shift, fluorescence in the blue or green region of the spectrum. So it fluoresces, it emits light around 520 to 530 nanometers. The Stokes shift is the difference between the absorption wavelength and the emission wavelength. And we can take a look at how that comes about on the next slide. This is a Jablonski diagram. It's an energy diagram that shows the various electronic states. And so, for example, for danzo chloride, these might be pi states, and then the excited states might be empty pi star states. And so the absorption of a photon of light will cause an electron to be populating one of the pi star states. And in the initial absorption, that light is going to enter into a higher excited state. The lowest excited state is known as the S1 or the singlet state. A higher excited state will relax by an internal conversion process down to the S1 state, and that all takes place in a very short period of time. Now, the S1 state might live for several nanoseconds before it either undergoes an inter-system crossing. We'll ignore that for now, but I'll just simply say that's how phosphorescence comes about. We don't need to worry about that too much. Mostly what happens is, after the relaxation down to the S1 state, that molecule sits around in an excited state for a nanosecond or so, and then it emits a photon and returns that electron back to the ground state, and we see the appearance of light. The Stokes shift that I mentioned on the previous slide comes about because there's a difference in energy between the absorbance and the fluorescence. That difference in energy comes about because the molecule relaxes from a higher excited state to that lowest excited state, S1, and that difference in energy is the same energy as the Stokes energy. Okay, so there's several methods in chemical analysis and molecular biology that depend on fluorescence and also on chemiluminescence. So it was at this point I thought I would introduce the idea of chemiluminescence, because you might encounter this. Certainly it is a number of assays, a number of light-based assays that involve the generation of light by a chemical means. So for example, the firefly is a good example of something that has a protein which is capable of combining with this small molecule shown here in a way that it can produce directly an excited state species. So if you pay attention to this four-membered ring, this four-membered ring is able to undergo decomposition to produce a molecule of CO2. When that four-membered ring, which contains a lot of strain energy, undergoes this reaction, it doesn't produce the ground state. It produces the molecule in an excited state directly. And that excited state is represented by this asterisk. That excited state then can emit a photon of light, and so from a chemical reaction which produces a molecule in its excited state, a fluorescent-like species can produce or emit light, and that can be used as another way of performing chemical analysis, a unique spectroscopic signature.